to open my eyes this morning, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for being closed in our right now. Oh, God, I thank you for the use and activity of my hands. Thank you, God, for brand new mercies this morning. Oh, God, and your unmerited favor, Lord. Not that we deserve anything but you, such a loving God, God. I just want to thank you one more time, Lord. You allow us to come out to your house and worship one more time. Oh, God, look on us this morning as we come and communicate and participate in this Sunday school. Oh, God, bless our teacher this morning. Who's going to teach your word, God? Stand with her this morning, Lord, when she opens her mouth, God. Oh, God, your Holy Spirit will tell you. Speak for her this morning, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God, look on our entire church as a whole, from the least to the greatest, starting with our pastor and first lady, God. Lord God, all of the leaders, Lord, Lord God, every president of every auxiliary blessing, in the name of Jesus. Look on even the little children, God, touch them, God. Make them strong, God, show them the way. Lead them and guide them in the name of Jesus. Oh, God, don't forget about the sick and afflicted and the bereaved families this morning, Lord. So many are going through bereavements, Lord. Their hearts are heavy this morning. Oh, God, the men broken hearts and healed, wounded spirits in the name of Jesus. Do it, God. I know you can do it. You did it before and you will do it again. I want to tell you thank you this morning. Continue to bless God. We come before your throne of mercy, Lord. We in need of your mercy. And, oh, God, when we come together for the last time, oh, God, we don't know when, we don't know where, but, God, I just thank you for this day, God. When it's all over, God, give us time that's already prepared for us. In the name of Jesus, I pray this morning. Amen. Amen.
Have in Jesus all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Amen. Amen. We come this morning in our lesson, we're going to see that He is a friend. Jesus is a friend of ours. Amen. Jesus is a friend of ours. Thank God, thank God. We come this morning for this Sunday school lesson hour. We thank God for each of you that's here. Amen. We thank God. We thank God. Look at our lesson today. Today we have a very good lesson. Which every Sunday is a good lesson because it's telling us what God will have us to know. Amen. But today's lesson talks about praise God for justice and righteousness. And the commentary says, praise for God's ultimate justice. God's ultimate justice. We thank God for this lesson today. Our key verse, text verse says, He rules the world in righteousness, and He judges the people with equity. In reading the background scripture in Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes allows us to know that there is a time and a purpose for everything. There's a time and a purpose for everything. But regardless of what we do, at the end of it, we need to know that the ultimate justice of what we do and how we do it comes from God. And there's nothing we can do to change that. It has been from the beginning, and it will be to the end. Because He is the beginning and He's the ending. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He is the first and He is the last. And He is the soon to come. Amen? Amen. So we look at our lesson this morning, praise for God's ultimate justice. And we see this lesson this morning as a Psalm of David. David wrote this song, and we see David has a message for us this morning. God has a message for us this morning. Through his servant David, of the trials that David went through, the things that David experienced. But what we're going to see today is that everything that David experienced, every battle that David won, was because God was with him fighting the battle for him. And his enemies, they thought they had the upper hand. But we're going to see in today's lesson where God, the ultimate justice, had the last word. So whatever happens, we know that it's going to be God. Amen. So our lesson takes place this morning in Psalms, ninth division, verses 1 through 12. And we start with verse number 1, where David says, I will give thanks to you, Lord, with all my heart. He says, I will tell of you of all your wonderful deeds. And the NIV reads it, but it says it pretty much the same thing in the way it reads. It says, I will praise thee, O Lord, with my whole heart. He says, I will show forth all thy marvelous works. Now, when we look at praise, we're talking about bearing public witness for God and the things that God would have us to do and know and live. He says, I will give thanks to you, O Lord, with all my heart. I will tell of all your wonderful deeds. And when we talk about praise, praise is expressing to God our appreciation and understanding of his word. It is saying thank you for each aspect of his divine nature. Our inward attitude becomes outward expressions. When we praise God, we help ourselves by expanding our awareness of who he is. Amen? The inward attitude, because it starts from the inside, right? From the inside out. We serve him from the inside out. It has to start with the heart. Amen? So it says that when we do this, we help ourselves by expanding our awareness of who he is. Verse 2 says, I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing the praises of your name, O Most High. Verse 3 says, my enemies turn back. They stumble and perish before you. And this says that our praise should reflect a heart that is filled with thanksgiving. When our hearts overflow with gratitude for all that God has done for us, joyful praise will flow forth abundantly from our lips. When we thankfully acknowledge all that God has done for us, others will see a difference in our lives. And so they want to know why. Just think about that. Sometimes we have our lives are the only Bible that some people will read. And if our lives do not reflect who God is, then we're sending the wrong message, amen? So we need to be able to acknowledge who he is so that someone might want to know why we act the way we do, why we live the way we do, why we talk the way we do. And then we can tell them. And that's what we do when we're doing that. We're spreading the gospel. We allow them to know what Jesus wants us to know, what Jesus wants us to get along to them. Verse 3 says, my enemies turn back. They stumble and perish before you. Among the glorious blessings God's people have is victory over enemies. Considering all that he has done for Israel, from their deliverance from the Egyptian bondage to the conquest of the promised land, to his continued victory over their enemies. Through the centuries, God's people have every reason to proclaim the marvelous deeds of the enthroned and only true righteous judge, because he is the only one. Now, look at verse 4. Verse 4 says, for you have upheld my rights and my cause, sitting enthroned as the righteous judge. It says, for thou hast maintained my rights and my cause. Thy safest, thou sittest in the throne, judging right. Though believers today have not conquered the promised land, we haven't got there yet. There is victory by faith in our Lord. For everyone born of God overcomes the world, even our faith. And in 1 John 5:4 from the NIV, he says, for everyone born of God overcomes the world. So this is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. By faith, we're saved, right? That's the only way, by faith. It has to come by faith. God upholds our just cause. He is our vindicator. One who cleans us from criticism and justifies us before others. In this life, we may face many injustices. One, we may be falsely accused and misunderstood by friends and enemies. Two, we may not be truly appreciated by others for the love we show. Three, the true value of our work and service may not be duly rewarded. And our ideas may be ignored. But God is to be praised, for he sees and remembers all the good we do. And it is up to him to decide the timing and the appropriateness of our rewards. If we do not trust him to vindicate us, then we will be susceptible to hatred and self-pity. If we do trust him, we can experience God's peace and be free from the worry of how others perceive us and treat us. Listen to what the Lord is saying to us this morning. God is the one that's going to vindicate us. We want to show revenge. But God said revenge belongs to him. Because for that one deed that person did to us that we want to do to annihilate them, God sees all the good from that person from day one up until that one thing that person did. And we want to annihilate them for one thing. And God is saying, I am the ultimate judge. That one thing might be there, but what about everything else that has come from the beginning up to now that God wants to reward us for? He says, you have rebuked the nations and destroyed the wicked. That's verse 5. You have rebuked the nations and destroyed the wicked. So you have blotted out their name forever and ever. Look what God does. God is saying, God, you have rebuked the nations and destroyed the wicked. You have blotted out their name forever and ever. Only God can do that. Only God himself can do this. In this verse, it says, this verse establishes several of the great deeds for which David is giving thanks to God. First, God rebuked these enemies of Israel. Built into the idea of rebuke are concepts like correction, scolding, reprimand. By defeating these hostile nations, the Lord strongly condemned their sins. He showed in a dramatic way that their aggression was wrong. Second, God accomplished the physical destruction of these wicked enemies. A drastic victory, our invaders met. Those forces would not sit back to fight against Israel ever again. So God was showing David, it is me. But when you come up against me, because you served me, David, you don't have to worry about it. Because I'm going to do what? I'm going to fight your battle. There's a song that says, this is how I fight my battle. This is how I fight my battle. We fight our battle with who? With God going before us. Because we don't have the power to do it ourselves. But we do it with God fighting it. Third, it said the Lord blotted out their name forever and ever. Blotting is the act of removing a stain, covering over, dissolving, or erasing from existence. That's what we might do. But in the biblical context, the phrase blot out typically means a total annihilation of a person, place, a nation. Now think about Jonah. When God told Jonah to go to Nineveh and speak to the Ninevites, he told Jonah what to do and what to say. Jonah decided he didn't want to do it. Why? Because Jonah wanted God to annihilate those Ninevites. But God knew what he wanted for his people. And all Jonah had to do was obey. When he did, he went the wrong way. But guess what? He ended up going anyway. And when he went, what did God do with the Ninevites? He didn't annihilate them, but then he did his day there. And today, in this time and day, God is still doing the same thing. There are people that might want us to be annihilated because of something that we've said, something that we've done, a place we've gone that we should never go. But God is saying, well, that's my child. I'm the ultimate judge. You don't get to do this. I do. Amen? For example, when we look in Exodus 17:14, it says it records the Lord's word about Amalek. After Joshua and his people defeated the Amalekites, the Lord said to Moses, he said, write this as a memorial in a book and recite it in the ears of Joshua, that I will utterly blot out the memory of Amalek from under heaven. Now, God is speaking to Moses. When he told Moses, he said, do what? He said, write it as a memorial in a book. I'm going to blot out some things. But if you write it in the book, he said, then I will tell you to do what? I want you to recite it with. In the ears of Joshua, that I will utterly blot out the memory of Amalek from under heaven. Now, let's go back to 9/11. What happened in 9/11? Do we often think about what happened in 9/11? We don't until an anniversary comes or somebody talks about what happened on 9/11. We know what happened on 9/11 when those planes hit the two twin towers. But it is something that we remember it every day. For some people, for the ones that were smaller, they don't even remember what happened. It's been what? It's been blotted out. Why was it blotted out? Why is it blotted out? Do we know the answer to that? No, we don't. Only who knows that? God does. But he knows why those planes hit the twin towers. Do we know God's purpose for it? We don't know, do we? We can assume what it was, but what we do know is that God sends and God what allows. So he either sent this tragedy or he allowed it to happen for his purpose. But then again, let's go back to Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes says what? That there's a time and a purpose and a defense for everything. So when twin towers were hit, it was the time and the purpose for it. Do we understand it? No, we don't. But we know it happened, amen? We just know. Now, in Exodus 24:4, Moses carefully wrote down all the Lord's instruction. He followed what God said. 34:27, he says, and the Lord said to Moses, write down all these instructions, for they represent the terms of my covenant with you and with Israel. Deuteronomy 29:19, he says, let none of those who hear the warning of this curse consider themselves, thinking, I am safe, even though I am working in my own stubborn way. We've got to be careful, because God is what? The ultimate justice for us. Look at verse number 6. Verse 6 says, in this ruins has overtaken my enemies. You have uprooted their cities, even the memory of them has perished. In this ruin has overtaken my enemies. You have uprooted their cities, even the memory of them have perished. Now, although David is celebrating judgments in his past, these words preview a future judgment as well. Just as God overthrew the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, leaving them in ashes and smoke, we know what happened in Sodom and Gomorrah, even so he will overthrow the cities of the nations that oppose him and his people at the end of tribulation period. Now, this is part of the end time. Revelation 16:19 reports, the great city was split into three parts, and the cities of the nation fell, and God remembered Babylon the Great to make her drain the cup of wine and the fury of his wrath. Someday, cities that revel in sin and oppose God will fade from memory. He was doing it then, but guess what? He's still doing it now. Things that God wants to be faded from our memory, he does it. Because he is the ultimate judge. Verse number 7 says, the Lord reigns forever. He has established his throne for judgment. Verse 8, he says, he rules the world in righteousness, and he judges the people with equity. Again, we come back to it. Only God can do it. It doesn't matter what we see. We can see an accident, and we can try to tell it to the best of our ability. But only God can take every little piece of fragment that came from that accident and put it back together and give the true report. Because sometimes our eyes deceive us. We think we know. We think we heard the right thing. But sometimes we didn't hear the right thing. We heard what we heard. We reported what we heard, and we reported what we saw, but does that mean it was now, because we don't have the capacity to do it. We see things from the physical. Do we always look through the eyes of God, through the spiritual? No, we don't. So again, when we do things like that, we have to remember that we too, even though as much as we want to be right, sometimes we come up short because we are still a part of humanity. We're working toward the promised land. We haven't got there yet. So we are still working towards it. Okay? So he says, in verse 6, he says, in this ruin has overtaken our enemies. You have uprooted their cities, even the memory of them has perished. Verse 7, the Lord reigns forever. He has established his throne for judgment. He rules the world in righteousness, and he judges the people with equity. Now, when we look at this, David acknowledges that God is, has been, and always will be the supreme authority over all of creation. That rule is not only complete, but also completely good. Okay? Verse 8 says, he rules the world in righteousness, and he judges the people with equity. Now in Psalm 32:2, the psalmist addresses the Lord saying, your throne is established from of old. You are from everlasting to everlasting. Psalms 106:48 proclaims, blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. He says, from his throne, God will judge the world in righteousness by man whom he has appointed, with Jesus. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. So we have assurance. We know he went to the cross. He died on the cross. He died for every last one of us. For all our past sins, for our future sins, but there's something that we have to do. He loves us unconditionally. He loves us unconditionally. But for us to be what he wants us to be, it comes with conditions. Obey his commands and his statutes. He loves us unconditionally. Does he not? Yes, but there are conditions that come with us worshiping and praising and serving him. We have to do it this way. When Jesus ministered on earth, he demonstrated divinely perfect judgment, rooted in perfect knowledge. John 1:47 tells us Jesus commended, he commented on Nathanael when the future disciple was first approaching him. When Nathanael asked Jesus how he knew him, Jesus replied, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, he says, I saw you. John 1:48. John 2:24-25 tells us Jesus did not entrust himself to the Passover crowd because he knew all people and needed no one to bear witness about man. It says that he himself knew what was in man. So what does that say to us this morning? God knows every last one of us. He knows every last one of us from the very beginning when we were born until we leave this earth. He is the only one. Nobody has to tell him about us because he already knew. And we do pray for each other. We ask God to heal. We ask God to deliver. We ask God to save. There's nothing wrong with that. But guess what? God already knew us. He knew from the foundation of the world about us. Every hair on our head, he knew how many was going to be there from the very beginning. So he didn't need man because he knew all people and needed no one to bear witness about man. For he himself knew what was in man. Verse 9 says, the Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. Isn't that good to hear this morning? Because we go through so much. In these last almost 2 years, we've been going through some things. Even those of us who thought we were really strong in Christ. When this pandemic hit, what did it do for us? It made some of us cowed, didn't it? We had to look at things a different way. It made some of us start praying that never prayed before. But it changed us. But we have to remember that the Lord, as verse 9 says, the Lord is a refuge for the oppressed. He's a stronghold in times of trouble. So it doesn't matter what we go through, what comes upon us. Again, we have to realize that God, what He sends and He allows. And even in His sending and His allowing, He's still what? He's still with us. When we go through the storms, He's in the storms with us. When we're having pain, He is right there with us. So it doesn't matter whatever it is that we go through. If someone else is oppressing us, guess what? God is there. Because again, we have to praise God for God's ultimate justice. It is He and He alone that can do this. So this verse 9 is a verse I believe that resonates with all of us. It says, the Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. And we've had some sickness in our church. We've had some death in our church. If we could stop that, guess what we would do? We would stop it, wouldn't we? Because we don't want people to hurt. We don't want people to lose loved ones. We don't want people to be oppressed. We don't want that in their lives. But guess what? It's not something that we can stop. We can ask God to help us. But what we need to remember is what verse 9 says again, that the Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. Now, David here mentions the oppressed, which implies people abused by those who exercise control over them. The Hebrew word implies something being crushed or harassed. Perhaps the abusers were political rulers or wealthy landowners. God is identified as a stronghold for those who are abused in such ways. In Hebrew terminology, a stronghold was a high, safe refuge. So when we think about God as being what? A high, safe refuge for us. It was a place where people could seek security from attackers or enemies. David often resorted to strongholds during his wilderness experience. But he felt safest in his reliance on the Lord. The Psalms of Korah write in Psalms 46:1, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Psalms 91:2 says, declares, I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. When adversity is extreme, those who trust in the Lord can turn to the Lord for safety. He is infinitely more powerful than any abuser. So regardless of what we come up against, regardless of what we face, God is stronger. He is wiser. He is the only true God. He is the only wise God. The Apostle John assures believers, he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. John 1 John 4:4. So greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. So we have an advocate. The Bible allows us to know. And we need to read it and study. The Bible studies the truth as a proof for a workman that need not be ashamed of rightly divide the word of truth. So when we know what the word of God says, and we go through tribulations, and we go through trial periods of hurt and of being oppressed, we know what the Bible says. Greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. But it doesn't say we're not going to go through anything. It just says greater is he that is in the world. But we know he'll carry us through it, right? Verse 10 says, those who know your name trust in you, for you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek you. Isn't that good to know? David says, he says to God, those who know your name trust in you, for you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek you. Have God ever forsaken any of us? No. Sometimes we ask God for things, we pray God for things, and they don't come to us the way we ask for them. They don't come to us the way we think they ought to come. We don't get sometimes what we ask for. Because some of us sometimes we ask for things, but we don't, what we're asking for is not what God wants us to have. So if it's not what God wants us to have, guess what? God's not going to give it to us. But he will give us what we need, because he declares in his word what? That I will what? I will provide all of your needs. When he says what? According to my riches and glory. In him. Yes, in Christ Jesus. That's what we're talking about this morning. God, praise for God's ultimate justice. So everything we talk about this morning is God's ultimate justice. Anything and everything that we do, it is God. says, those who know you know your name, trusting you, for you know it. And you see that in all chapter 1, the Lord, L-O-R-D, has never forsaken those who seek you. Now here David notes that God is with his people, not just when everything is going smoothly. He is even there when trials buffet them. In Psalms 23, David testifies that the Lord is his shepherd. He is David's shepherd when he makes him lie down in green pastures, or when leads him beside still waters. The Lord is also David's shepherd in the valley of the shadow of death. David fears no evil because the Lord is with him. That's Psalm 23. Now, Hebrews 13:5 assures believers that the Lord will never forsake them. God will never abandon those who seek him. God's promise does not mean that if we trust in him, we need to hear this, people. We need to hear this. Because sometimes we think, people say, well, when you got Jesus, you got all you need. That's all you need. We need to be careful about that statement. But when you got him, it's all you need. Yes, that's what we need. But he also knows we need someone here. He put people here for us. Because we become with his eyes, his hands, his mouthpiece, his feet. So yes, we do need him. But God also does something else for us. And it says here that God will never, let me go back to Hebrews 13:5, assures believers that the Lord will never forsake them. God will never abandon those who seek him. God's promise does not mean that if we trust in him, we will escape loss or suffering. It means that God himself will never leave us, no matter what we face. So having God in our lives is good. We need him. We need him every day of our lives. But let's not misunderstand and think that because we have him in our lives, that we're not going to suffer. Affliction will come upon us. But guess what it says to us now? That he will be with us always. He said he will never leave us, and he will never forsake us. So does that mean sickness will not come? Yes, sickness will come. Will death come? Yes, death is going to come. Because he says, man that's born of a woman is what? For a few days. And those days are what? Full of trouble. Now, does that mean everybody's going to die out? Not necessarily. Because he says when he comes back, he says what? The dead in Christ is going to do what? They're going to rise first. But then he says something else. He says those that what? That yet remain. Does that mean we're going to be here? We don't know who's going to be here. But he says that those that yet remain is going to be taken out in a moment in the twinkling of an eye. So we have his word to stand on. That's all we have. When you really think about it, everything that we have, nothing compared to who he is. He is what we have. Everything we own belongs to him. Everything where we live belongs to him. What we drive belongs to him. What we wear belongs to him. It all belongs to him. So it means then that we do not expect loss or suffering. It means that God himself will never leave us, no matter what we face. Let's look at verse 11. Verse 11 says, and we're going to be done in a few minutes. It says, sing the praises of the Lord, enthroned in Zion. Proclaim among the nations what he has done. God does not only live in Jerusalem, or Zion, which is another name for Mount Moriah. He says, the hill on which the temple was built. He is everywhere at the same time. The focus point of Israelite worship, however, came to be Jerusalem and its beautiful temple. God was present in the tabernacle in Exodus 25:8-9, and in the temple built by Solomon in 2 Chronicles 7:16. From this central place of worship, the Jews were to tell the world about the one true God. When we call on God for help, it should be to bring glory, to bring God glory and honor. The Lord is good all the time. David exhorts God's people to tell others about the Lord deeds. The deeds David refers to are likely the wonderful acts the Lord performed on behalf of Israel. Now, when we go back and we look at and listen to today's Psalms 9, it is verses 1 through 12. But when we look at verse number 11, you can go back to verses 1 through 6 because this is what David is talking about. have a wonderful act the Lord performed on behalf of Israel. His deliverance of his people from Egypt and his miraculous provisions for them in the wilderness. It could be more personal, what God has done in the lives of the oppressed. Believers today should declare how much God has done for them. God wants us to tell people about the good things that happens to us, the things that he has done for us, because everything that has happened to us is because of him. Now, when we talk about good things, there are some things that are bad things that happen to us, but he also wants us to be able to talk to someone about that too. Because if they're going through what we have gone through, or is going through, we can be a witness of what God will do and how God will bring us out from that. Now, when we talk about the good things of God, in Luke 8:39, the man that was demon-possessed, when he took those demons out of him, he begged to go with Jesus. But what did Jesus say to him? He says, no, go back to your family. He wants to tell about him. He says, go back to your family. He says, and tell them all the wonderful things that God has done for you. And look what the demon-possessed man did. He went all through the city telling about the great things that Jesus had done. He spread the word of God. He told them what happened to him. But then he looked at where he was at that point, and the demon was gone. Because God had done what? He had healed him. In 1 Peter 2:9-10, he says, his very own possession to show others the goodness of God, called out of darkness into his marvelous light. But he says, you are what? A chosen people. You are a kingdom of priests. You are God's what? Holy nation. God has called us out of darkness of what? Into his marvelous light. And when he had done that for us, he wants us to do what? Tell somebody else. It doesn't stop here. It doesn't stop here. There's a song that says, it's not the building that he wants to feel, that God wants to feel. It's not the building that he wants to feel. It's our heart. It says, this empty space is where he wanted our love. We fight to build up a church. We fight to bring in people. Fight to make it fuller. But the psalm says, it's not the building he wants to fill. It's our hearts. This empty space is where he wanted all along. And if he fills this space, guess what happened? Then the church is where it needs to be, isn't it? Because we are what? We are the church. It's not the building. It's the church that God wants. Amen? So he wants us to tell of his marvelous work. Oh, the goodness of God. Okay. That was in verse 11, right? Sing the praises of the Lord from Zion. Proclaim among the nations what he has done. So he wants us to do this. Also in 1 Peter 3:15, he says, faith is not a personal matter to keep to oneself. It should be shared. Be prepared to tell what Christ has done in your life. Romans 10:14-15 says, how shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe if they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? He says, how shall they preach then except they be sent? How beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. Now, what are those good things? Praise for God's ultimate justice. He is always with us. Verse 12 says, for he who avenges blood remembers. He does not ignore the cries of the afflicted. We go back with our lesson subject today. Praise for God's ultimate justice. And verse 12 says, for he who avenges blood remembers. He does not ignore the cries of the sick. What is he talking about in verse number 12? For he who avenges blood remembers. We're talking God, aren't we? God himself. Yes. He does not ignore the cries of the afflicted. He does not ignore the cries of the afflicted. Psalm 72:14 says, he will save them from oppression and from violence, for their lives are precious to him. precious to God. He wants us to know His word. He wants us to be able to live according to how He wants us to live, knowing that He will see us through every storm because He is our refuge and our strength. He says, revenge is not something those who believe in God should pursue. We don't pursue revenge. Revenge is not something those who believe in God should pursue. The Lord settles the score on behalf of His oppressed people. Romans 4:19. He is aware of their struggles. The ultimate source of retribution for evil is not human revenge. It is God's judgment. Deuteronomy 32:35, Hebrews 10:30. Deuteronomy says, I will take vengeance. I will repay those who deserve it. In due time, their feet will slip. Their day of disaster will arrive, and their destiny will overtake them. Isn't that good to know? Look what God is saying to us. Look what He is saying to us. In Deuteronomy 32:35, God says, I will take revenge. I will repay those who deserve it. We can't do it. Because regardless of what we do to a person, it can never be what God's going to do. Doesn't matter how we do it, it's not going to be what God's going to do. But we might want to kill. But God might say, no, they deserve something, but they may not be deserved to die. I can give them, I can allow whatever I need to allow. And I can give revenge, but you might want death. But I don't want death. And we gave the example of Jonah with the Ninevites. Jonah said, annihilate them. But God said, no, He didn't want it. So He says, well, I will repay them who deserve it. In due time, their feet will slip. Look what God's saying. In due time, we got it all together, that we've done what we need to do, and we done, I've got you back, and I've done everything I need to do. And God says, well, when we think we got it together, the first thing that we think, but I will bring to us, He said, in due time, their feet will do what? Will slip. He said, in their day of distaste, a disaster will arrive. And their destiny will do what? Will overtake them. So what we think and how we think is going to end, it's not going to be. It's going to be what God says. And then when we look at Hebrews 10:30, it says, I will take vengeance, I will repay those who deserve it. The Lord will judge His own people. We belong to God. We belong to Him. Whether we're saved or not saved, we speak as people. So we either are saved people or we are unsaved people. But whatever our end is going to be, it's going to be. As a saved people of God or as an unsaved person of God. Because God's going to do what He's going to do. And it says here, we give praise for God's ultimate justice. And we know His ultimate justice is going to take place. We don't know when. The Bible tells us we don't know when, we don't know where, but we know it's going to take place. So we have to be concerned about that. It says evidence that God does not forget the suffering of His people is given in the story of the Exodus from Egypt. When the Lord appointed Moses to lead the Hebrews out of Egypt, He said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. These were the oppressors. He says, I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them out of the hands of the Egyptians. If He did it then, can He do it now? Yes, He can. Exodus 3:7-8. Instead of fretting about an oppressive situation, believers should heed the Paul's exhortation to make their request known to God with prayers and supplication, with thanksgiving, and receive the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding. So He says then, for He who avenges blood remembers, God will remember, and He does not ignore the cries of the afflicted. So when we cry out to God, guess what? He hears us. He hears us. He said He will never leave us, and that He will never what? He will never forsake us. And I love this part of it in the very ending here, where it says, instead of fretting about an oppressive situation, someone's oppressing us with something, if we're going through some situation, he said, believers should He calls exhortation. He says to make our request known to God with prayers and supplication, with thanksgiving, and receive the work, the peace of God. And this peace of God they talk about, is this a peace that the world can give us? No. If we're looking for peace to come in our hearts from the world, we will never get it. Because the world cannot give us peace. The world is not even our peace. Right now, when you look all over the world, something is going on almost every country, every state, you name it. Something is happening. Even before the pandemic hit, there was a lot of things going on. Look at Afghanistan. Look at in Israel. All over. There's so much going on right now. So he says what? He says, receive the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding. So let's just take a look at this. When we see the things that are happening right now with the pandemic and everything that's happening, we ask ourselves, how can you have peace? How can you have peace with that? Just kind of ponder that for a minute. How can you have peace with that? Is it possible to have peace with that? We can have it. We have to have God. We got to be where our lesson talks about today. And I was reading something here in the Echoes book. Where was it? I said, I'm going to just kind of read it this morning. Okay, here we go. And you might have it in your book, and we're going to close. We've got about 2 minutes. It says, knowing God's name. Knowing God's name gives us great assurance that he will never leave or forsake his people, for the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous runneth into it and is safe. As the prophet Isaiah proclaimed, this is what the high and exalted one says. He who lives forever, whose name is holy, and live in a high and holy place, but also with the one who is contrite and lowly in spirit, to revive the spirit of the lowly and to revive the heart of the contrite. So regardless of how high we think, the highest is still God. The lowest is still God. The deepest is God. The widest is God. So you can't go over him. You can't go around him. You can't go through him. You can't go beneath him. So we got what? It is still God. It says we can trust him in every aspect of life. But we must first know his name. When I read that, I kind of thought about it. So, you know, we know it already. But this lesson just brought it back as a remembrance that in order for that to happen, we can trust him in every aspect of life. But we must first know his name. Not just heard about his name, but we must know his name. Because in other words, we need to know who God truly is. Know who he is. Acknowledge him in everything we do. What the verse says? Trust in God with all your heart. Lean not into your own understanding. But in all our ways, acknowledge him and says he will do what? He will direct our path. You know what? Sometimes it may not seem like it's easy, but you know what? God makes it so easy for us if we just know what he's saying, and not just know what he's saying, but do what he's saying. It works for us. When I read that, I said, okay, that's what you're talking about. Trust in the Lord with all our heart. Give him everything. Lean not to your own understanding. We don't understand. We don't have the power to do it. But do it with him. And so he will do what? He will direct our path. Have you ever gone there to say, oh, today I'm going to go do whatever? And somewhere in that day, God chooses to send you somewhere else. And at the end of the day, you look at it and you say, no, I had no intention of going there. I had no intention of doing that. But God directed my steps. And when he directed it, he put me where I needed to be, to do what he needed me to do. And that's the way we have to look at it. When we start the day, we have to say, God, where do you want me today? What is it that you want me to do today? Not what I want, because what I might be going in the wrong direction. I might be a general. I might be headed to Texas. And I'm probably going down the neighborhood. Send me in the right direction, God, so that I will be where you need me to be. In other words, we need to know who God truly is. It says it is our responsibility to get to know our Lord. And we do it by spending time with him in prayer, in personal Bible study, and in church with other believers in order to worship together and to hear the preaching and teaching of his word. There is indeed refuge and protection for those who know his name. So let us purpose to draw closer to him day by day to get to know his name. To get to know his name. Amen. Amen. That's our lesson today. Our lesson today, praise for God's ultimate justice. And in the echoes it says, praise God for justice and righteousness. So it's worshiping God. They're worshiping God in joy, God for our defense, God our judge in first place, and at the very end, let all praise God. Amen. It's our lesson for today. At this time, if there's no questions, at this time, we're going to turn it over to our pastor, Bishop Tony Moss.
It's a blessing in the eyes of each and every one of you. We do thank God for Sister Souter and the teaching of this lesson. And the theme is praise for God's ultimate justice. And we know that David had a right to cry for justice.
Mm-hmm.
But I write the four things that he declared in the first two stanzas of this lesson.
Mm-hmm.
He said, I will give thanks. To you, Lord, with all my heart,
mm-hmm.
I will tell of all your wonderful deeds.
Mm-hmm.
I will be glad and rejoice in you, and I will sing the praises of your name, O Most High.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I write the Bible because the lesson also dictates that sometimes we exaggerate in certain areas of our life and certain statements or comments that we may make. We exaggerate. There's no exaggeration when it comes to praising our God.
Amen.
Amen. We can praise him because he's the Most High God.
Mm-hmm.
And we can praise him with all our heart, all our hands, and all our souls.
No limit.
Amen, somebody.
Amen.
But the Bible said, you're ashamed of what?
Only.
I will be what?
Ashamed of only.
And I will not do what? I will not declare your name. So there's no limit to praising God. Amen. So we thank God for our Sunday school teacher. We thank God for our superintendent that is present in the person of Deacon Souter. And in the absence of our assistant, Sunday school assistant, in the person of Deacon John Ryan. But we thank God for you being here and pray that you have learned something that you can carry and hold on to help you praise on through the storms of God. Amen.
Let us stand. Extend an invitation at this time. If you have one who have not given your life to Christ, there's no better time than now to do it. We know not the day nor the hour that the Son of Man shall appear. But when he appears, we want to be ready. Amen.
Amen.
We ask that you come. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. The same goes. Jacob will not lose his reward. Israel will be lost. The word of God is saying the same thing to us today. It has been extended. The time is now. There's no better time.